Community Church. It's great to have you with us today. If you are visiting with us for the very first time, it is our pleasure and delight to have you for Christmas 2015. There are some communication cards in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to take one, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag when it comes by in a few minutes, and next week through the mail, we'll give you information that tells you about New Hope. We'll do our best not to annoy you or aggravate you, but hopefully give you helpful information to let you know what goes on around here. Today, the theme is Christmas. It's personal. You know, over the years, I've been told I was short. I take that personally. Over the years, I've been told I'm not very pretty. I take that personally. But for 2,000 years, Jesus has told the world, I love you. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever would believe in him could have everlasting life and never perish. You and I need to take that personally. Until it becomes personal for us, it's not real. Until it becomes personal for us, our celebrations of Christmas are simply arbitrary and artificial. If you have taken Christmas personally in the past, I hope you'll renew your passion for it today. If you've never taken it personally in the past, I hope before this morning is over, you'll decide to give a serious personal look at what it means to be engaged with the true meaning of Christmas. O Holy Night, Kathy Murbach just sang for us. One of the lines in that song goes like this: a thrill of hope to a weary world. I know those words are personal for Kathy. She knows personally the strength that comes from hope when life can wear you out. In a little while, you're going to be hearing Amanda sing, Mary, Did You Know? And in that line, it says, Mary, did you know when you kissed your baby, you kissed the face of God? That song is going to be taken very personally by Amanda this year in a way that it never has been before. If you don't know Amanda, you'll discover in just a few moments she's pregnant with her first child. So I know this song she takes very personally. Jean is going to be singing for us this morning, When Blossoms Flower Mid the Snow. In that song, there's a line that says, let every verse proclaim his name. Jean has done that throughout his life. And in this song, he reminds us that faith flourishes through all the seasons of life. Whether it's springtime or whether it's winter, God can make our lives thrive through all the transitions in life. And Jean's living through that at this very moment. Going Home for Christmas. This song is very personal to Milo, our worship leader here at New Hope. In that song, there's a line that says, this gift will be worth more to me than anything on earth. I'm going home. I'm going home for Christmas. And in the song, that's the words of a mother who's dying. That is extremely personal to Milo, for that transpired this year for him. Personal. Christmas is personal in each of these. An ensemble is going to follow up with an evening in December, and this kind of lifts our spirits just a little bit. Glad we're here together, and that's how we feel about you this morning. Glad you're here. And it reminds us of the value that we should put on relationships, and we shouldn't take any one of those relationships for granted. And after the message, the choir will come back and wrap up our morning with King of Glory, King of Love. His name is Jesus, precious Jesus. Jesus is not precious any day of the year, but particularly at Christmas, if you haven't taken Christmas personal. And so I hope this Christmas, it gets really personal for you. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. The only announcement I have to make today is that December the 24th is still Christmas Eve. And at 9 p.m. on Christmas Eve, the doors of New Hope will be open for our Christmas Eve service. It's usually about an hour to an hour and 10 minutes. And we invite you to come and join us for that Christmas Eve service. It's a come-as-you-are service. If you've been out to dinner and you're dressed to the nines, come all dolled up. If you're already in your comfy cozies for the evening, put a big heavy robe on and come join us that night. And it's a time of fun. It's a time of encouragement. It's a time of hope. And we're going to kind of wrap up the theme of Advent conspiracy that our high school group has introduced to us since Thanksgiving. Do you remember what Advent conspiracy is? Four things. Worship. All right. Spend.
Less.
Give.
More.
Love. And we're going to wrap that up, all right? And Pastor Chris is going to share some thoughts with us during that evening of how we can love all. And we're going to give you a chance that since you've spent less on Christmas, we're going to give you a chance that night to give more to a very special mission outreach that night. So we hope you'll come and join us. Would you join with me as we pray? Our Father, thank you for the life that we get to share with your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And the only reason that we can share that life is because our Father in heaven sent his Son to be one of us, to do for us what we could never do for ourselves. And because of his birth and his life and his crucifixion and his death and his resurrection, the scripture says our life is now hid in Christ and our hope is now found in Christ alone. And Lord, if there are those who are here this morning in any of our services, if there are those who are darkening the doors of churches for this Christmas Sunday, literally around the world, who have shown up with no hope, I trust they will discover the hope of glory, the reason for Christmas. Father, thank you for what you have been doing in the hearts of those who are singing this morning. Thank you for the message that will come clear from their voices. And thank you for the message that comes out of your word today. May you challenge all of our hearts. You know our needs, and may this be a day of surrender of those needs to you. For the privilege of giving today, Father, it's simply a testimony of the grand gift that you've given to us, eternal life. We say thanks in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior, the greatest gift of all. Amen. There was a small boy who was writing a letter to God about the Christmas presents that he badly wanted. I've been good for 6 months now, he wrote. But after a moment's reflection, he crossed out the 6 months and he wrote three. After a pause, that was crossed out and he put 2 weeks. There was another pause and he crossed that out too. He got up from the table and he went over to the little crib scene that had the figures of Mary and Joseph and baby Jesus. And he picked up the figure of baby Jesus and he went back to his writing again and he started again. Dear God, if you ever want to see your son again, boy, was this kid taking things personally, all right, that Christmas. You see, this is a time of year when we often think back to three wise men who went to find the baby Jesus. And according to the book of Matthew, they presented unto him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. These are simple words. But if we analyze them carefully, we discover an important yet often overlooked theological fact. In this account, there is no mention of wrapping paper on the gifts. If there had been wrapping paper, I think Matthew would have recorded it. It would have gone something like this. And lo, the gifts were encompassed with about 7 square cubits of paper. And the paper was covered within and without, with pictures of Frosty, a man of snow. And Joseph purposed in his heart to cast the paper in the barrel of refuge. But Mary saith unto him, cease, man, drop the decorative parchment. It should be set aside for future generations. And Joseph did roll his eyeballs. And it came to pass that the babe was more interested in the paper than in the frankincense. But those words do not appear in the Bible, which means that the very first Christmas gifts were not wrapped. This is because the people giving those gifts had two very important characteristics. Number one, they were wise. Number two, they were men. We're not big rappers, are we, guys? We don't understand the point of putting paper on a gift just so somebody else can rip it off. So here's a couple of gift wrapping tips for us men this morning. Whenever possible, by gifts already wrapped. We may not know much about wrapping, but I think all of us have learned all that we need to know about giving from God. Because you see, God is in the gift-giving business. Highlighted by the most memorized verse of the Bible, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son." But we can go back farther than that and see how giving God has been. God gave Adam and Eve a piece of skin from an animal to replace the fig leaves and cover the shame of their nakedness. God gave Noah a plan for the ark that would provide the saving of his household when judgment came. God gave Sarah a precious miracle child in her old age, and she named him Isaac. God gave the Israelites possession of a land that flowed with milk and honey. God gave prophets to plead with his people and tell them of amazing things to come. God gave the scriptures prophecy of a Messiah who would come and deliver and save us from ourselves. God gave to shepherds in a field a pronouncement by angels that in Bethlehem a baby had been born. God gave the wise men a star that would lead them to the young child with their gifts. God gave Joseph the patience to understand the strange circumstances of a virgin who was going to be his wife that was pregnant. God gave the world the Prince of Peace. God gave Jesus the place of sinners on a cross to bear our sorrow and shame. And Jesus gave his life for all us sinners. God offers to give all men the pardon of their sins that we can know the joy of everlasting life. God really is a great giver, isn't he? Mankind can learn a lot about giving from him. John tells us that God so loved the world that he gave his only son. James, the half-brother of Jesus, said every good gift and every perfect gift comes from above, and it comes down from the Father of lights. Jesus told the woman at the well, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that says to you, 'Give me to drink,' you would have asked of him, and he would have given to you living water." Paul said in Romans 8, "He that spared not his own son, shall he not also freely give to you and me all things?" And Paul said to the Ephesians, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, and not of yourselves." What is it? It is a gift of God. And I say along with Paul, thanks be to God for his unspeakable gift. This morning, I want to help us for a couple of minutes think through the idea of whether we are good receivers of the greatest gift that has ever been given. You see, a universal gift, "For God so loved the world." It's a gift made available to the universe. But a universal gift is not a gift until it's been personally accepted and appropriated. Here's what Jesus did. If you're looking for the perfect gift for that someone special, just as Jesus did for us, he made sure of a couple of essential things. First of all, and most important of all, he made it personal. The gift that God offers to you and me is personal to you and me, though it's available to the world. It was personally purchased specifically for you and me to meet our deepest need. He came for us. He did not just come for the rich. He didn't just come for the poor. He just didn't come for the popular. He didn't just come for the unknown. He did not just come for people of one ethnicity or another. He didn't just come for Jews and Gentiles. He came for us all. He didn't come just for the religious. He came for the irreligious. He came for the Hindu and the Muslim. He came for the Buddhist and he came for the atheist. He came for us all. He didn't have to. He was God. He didn't need us, but we needed him. When he lived here on earth, he was completely human. He felt heartache. He knew loneliness. He was tempted. He longed for companionship. He felt hunger. He knew what it was like to be tempted by women. When he left his earthly father's carpenter shop, I'm sure he probably thought, maybe I could wait. Maybe I should come back at another time. Maybe I should come back and die in a different generation when crosses are out of style. I would have opted for that choice. We don't like to think of Jesus in the human. We don't like to think about God being hungry, about being tempted. It almost seems sacrilegious, doesn't it? But he was completely man. The nails hurt his hands just like they would hurt yours. So why did he do it? He did it because he looked across time and he saw you and he saw me. He saw our hearts and he saw how we needed a Savior. So he gave to us the gift of himself. His gift is very personal. He gave himself for ourself. But have you accepted his gift personally? May I also suggest to you that God not only gave a personal gift, but it also a very pleasing gift. I can witness to you this morning that there is no greater gift that has ever been given to me than the gift I received on the third Thursday of June in 1960 when I accepted the gift of Jesus Christ personally. Just because my mom and dad were Christians didn't make me a Christian. Just because I was born in a parsonage, all right? I was born to parents who lived in a home where they were pastoring a church. That didn't make me a Christian. God gave to us the most pleasing gift we could ever ask for, and the gift of his son. The greatest need that any of us have is to be saved from ourselves and our sin. And Jesus Christ has provided that. I can tell you that he has satisfied for 55 years now the deepest longings in my heart. It is the only gift that I've ever been given that is more pleasing to me today than the day that I received it. It grows sweeter every single day. His gift of himself is pleasing. His gift is also permanent. The gifts that we give should be something that has lasting value, not something cheaply made that will break the very first day and tossed aside. I found it humorous about the guy that bought his wife a beautiful diamond ring for Christmas. A friend of him said, I thought your wife wanted a four-wheel drive vehicle. She did, the guy replied, but where am I going to buy a fake Jeep? Our gifts that we give ought to have lasting, permanent value. God gave us the permanent gift of eternal life. In John 10:28, Jesus said, and I gave unto them eternal life. For what purpose? That they should not perish. And no man can pluck them out of my hand. There is really nothing else that we could ever ask for or desire that is higher than this gift of Christ himself. Jesus laid down his own self that we could have this permanent gift. He wrapped himself in human flesh and he took upon himself man. He bore our sins and our shame. The King of Kings was born in a little stable. What a welcome to our earth he got. And he did all this so that we could have a forever gift. And then he paid in full for the gift that he gives. May I suggest to you, it's always a good idea that you pay for your gift before you walk out the store. That's just a good thing to do. Jesus has already paid for the gift of salvation for every one of us. Romans 5:15 says, but not as the offense, so also is the free gift. For if through the offense of one, in other words, the sin of Adam in the garden, that many die, much more the grace of God and the gift by grace, which by one man, that's pretty fair, isn't it? By one man's sin came upon the whole world. By one man, Jesus Christ, God with us, grace has abounded to many. James, again, the brother of Jesus, said every good gift, every perfect gift is from above, and it comes down from the Father of lights. Neither is there a shadow of turning in him. What is the best gift that you could give this Christmas? If you've never given your heart to Christ, there's no greater gift that you could give. And what is the best gift you could receive this Christmas? May I suggest to you his love? For Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 13, his love bears all things. Have you ever grown weary bearing the problems of those that you love? I have. You probably have too. The scripture says that the love of Christ never grows weary of bearing all things. The love of Christ endures all things. He puts up with you and me every day of our life. Love never ever fails. A universal gift is not a gift until it's taken personally. Here's the thoughts on this subject that God has whittled into my brain over these last couple of weeks. First of all, Christmas is not a holiday. It is a most holy day. Christmas is not a vacation relieving us of our responsibilities at work or at school. It is a celebration because we have been relieved of the burden of our sins and the condemnation of death and hell. We often like to remember and reflect on the idea that I'm not going, though I die, yet shall I live again. But we need to remember that it's by this gift of Jesus Christ that you and I never have to endure hell. The heaven we gain is the blessing of a relationship with Jesus Christ, and it is the benefit of not dying and going to a Christless eternity to a place called hell. Christmas was very personal to God the Father. You see, God the Father sent His only Son to face the consequences of His wrath against our sin. Do you realize, this is what dawned on me just this week, do you realize that the world's first Christmas, this night that you've heard sung about, that most holy night, do you realize that remarkable moment in the history of the world, that first time that Emmanuel, God, was with us, that God the Father spent His first Christmas without His Son? Do you realize that? He smacked me with that truth this week. I've been a little melancholy at times over the last couple of weeks because it occurred to me this will be the first Christmas that neither one of my sons will be with me at Christmas time. They're going to be over 2,000 miles away. I've got to be honest, there was a moment or two that there was a little bitterness starting to creep in. And I was thinking to myself, in 34 years, I've not had a son with me for Christmas. And that's when God said, hey, for all eternity past, I never had my son not with me. But I sent him to you because you needed what he had to offer. See, Christmas was personal to God as well. Christmas was very personal to Mary. The virgin mother of Jesus being chosen by God messed up her wedding plans and dreams. This was not what she had on her daytimer. Christmas was very personal to Joseph. He was the earthly father of Jesus. He had no intention of raising a child that was not his own. If you read the story, it's in your bulletin. You find it in Matthew chapter 1 and 2, and you find it in Luke chapter 2. And in Matthew chapter 1, the last part of that chapter, the scripture says, Joseph, being a righteous man, did not want to publicly disgrace Mary. So he was going to set aside his wedding plans privately. He could have openly had her stoned. We forget that sometimes. He could have openly had Mary stoned. But because he was God not only chose Mary to be the earthly mother of Jesus, God the Father also chose Joseph to be the earthly father of Jesus. And he chose well. The scripture says he was a righteous man. He showed her grace by not publicly disgracing her. But God gave Joseph more grace to do what he thought he could not do. Christmas was very personal to a handful of shepherds. Night watch was the most boring of all shepherd duties. That was until an angelic choir and a heavenly preacher showed up and told them about a babe in Bethlehem. They were told what they would find and where to find him. And who they found amazed them, and those shepherds, who were normally rather quiet men, ran out into the city and told others who they had found. And when you have found something of personal value, you can't wait to share it with others. I have pictures on my iPhone of my grandson, Bo, and he's not born yet. I'd be happy to show them to you. Why? Because Bo has personal value to me. I'm happy to show them to you. Does Jesus have personal value to you? If he does, how come you're not telling others about him? If you've escaped hell and have inherited heaven, If you're no longer afraid to die because you know that you're going to have life everlasting, why don't we want to run out and tell others this incredible truth? Christmas was very personal to a group of wise men. Do you guys realize, it just dawned on me this week, small groups got started in Bethlehem. Small group of shepherds came, found Jesus. Small group of wise men showed up, found Jesus. It's very biblical to be in a small group. Wise men seek truth, and they found Jesus. How wise are you? Christmas was very personal to Herod. The news of Jesus disturbed him. The presence of a baby in Bethlehem rocked his world, and he didn't want his world rocked. Herod was accustomed to rocking everybody else's world, so he rocked the world with a decree that all baby boys 2 years and younger be slaughtered so he could protect his dream world. Stubbornness and selfish ruled his day. Christmas was personal to a man named Simeon and a woman named Anna, an old man and an old woman who served and worshiped in the temple, and they were honored and blessed because of their faith to lay their eyes on the Redeemer child before they died, a reward in this life before they passed to the next. As Christians, we celebrate Christmas as the birth of Jesus, the promised Messiah. Jesus came to bring hope, forgiveness, and a change of heart. Christmas is about the miracle of transformation, but only if we take Christmas personal. Heart transplants are increasingly more common today than several decades ago. We have a good friend who lives in this town. He's a twin. He used to work out at Link Care Center, and he's taught out at the seminary. And he shares in a remarkable thing that he and his twin brother both have had heart transplants. And they've both lived for now over a decade with another person's heart in theirs because their heart was so diseased and bad. Boy, 5 decades ago, that was very uncommon. What Jesus has come to do is not a physical heart transplant, but a spiritual heart transplant. And this involves our will, the totality of our being surrendered to Christ. Heart transplants are increasingly more common than they were when Dr. Christian Barnard did the very first heart transplant in December of 1967. 1 month later, he transplanted a human heart into Dr. Philip Blayberg. After the surgery, Dr. Barnard carried the patient's heart, Dr. Blayberg's heart, into a plastic box, and he sat down on the bedside of the doctor who had a new heart in him, and the two of them sat on the bedside and examined this old, dead heart. Dr. Barnard said, "Dr. Blayberg, do you realize you were the first man in the history of humankind to sit and look at his own dead heart?" Dr. Blayberg received a new human heart to extend his life, and it did, by 19 months. Jesus came to transform the lives of people and give them a spiritual heart that will last for all eternity. When you understand the true meaning of Christmas, it brings about a change in our heart and an outlook on life. In the Christmas Carol, Scrooge lived a miserable life of greed. But when he awoke from the sobering encounter with the ghosts of Christmas past, present, and future, Scrooge sees his empty, bitter life for what it is. Have you ever seen your life for what it is apart from Christ? And Scrooge wanted his life to change, so he humbled himself. And he retraced the steps of the offenses committed on Christmas Eve. And as he did, he revealed a remarkable transformation of heart. Scrooge declares, "I will honor Christmas in my heart and try to keep it all year long. I will live in the past, the present, and the future. The spirits of all three shall strive with me, and I will not shut out the lessons in which they teach." Scrooge's life changes. Instead of grasping, now he's giving. Instead of being bitter, he's now loving. Instead of being indifferent to the needs of others, now he is caring and compassionate. Scrooge's life is transformed from humbug to hallelujah. Some of you could use that kind of transformation today. Why did Christ humble himself to human birth? Why did he trouble himself with adolescence? Why did he suffer himself with insufferable people? Why did he humiliate himself with betrayal, beatings, and crucifixion? At any point, Jesus could have said, "I quit." And why didn't he? Why did he keep on going? I wonder if Lee Lelpe understands the answer. Lee is a retired firefighter, a New York City firefighter. He gave 26 years to the city. But on September 11th of 2001, I have not offended those people who are getting up and walking out, all right? That was their cue for the last number, all right? Which is your cue that I'm just about finished. But Lee, on September 11th, 2001, he gave much, much more. On that day, Lee gave his son. You see, Jonathan Lelpe was a fireman too. When the 10 Twin Towers fell, he was there. Firefighters are a very loyal clan. When one perishes in the line of duty, the body is left where it is until a firefighter who knows the person can come and quite literally pick him up. Lee made the discovery of his son's body his own personal mission. He dug daily with dozens of others at that 16-acre graveyard. And on Tuesday, December the 11th, 3 months to the day after the disaster, his son was found, and Lee was there to carry his son home. He didn't give up. The father didn't quit. He refused to turn and leave. Why? Because the love for his son was greater than the pain of the search. Can't the same be said about Christ? Why didn't he quit? Because the love for his children was greater than the pain of his journey. He came to pull us out. Your world has collapsed. That's why he came. You were dead in your trespasses and sins. That's why he came. He loves you and he loves me. That's why he came. That's why he endured the distance between us. Love endures all things. That's why he endured the resistance from us. Love endures all things. That's why he went the final step of the incarnation. Paul writes about that in 2 Corinthians 5:21 when he says, God made him, who's the him? Jesus Christ, made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. I preached that several years ago. I had a man call me up that week, say, Pastor Tim, I'm never coming to your church again. And I said, how come? He said, because you said that my Savior became sin and my God is too good to ever become sin. I said, he did it for you. I said, do you want to inherit the righteousness of God? Listen to his words. He said, not at the price of admitting that Jesus became sin. Don't argue with me about that concept. Argue with God. You see, what part of the issue was? He didn't want to admit he was as big a sinner as he was. He didn't want to put onto Christ his own imperfection. But Jesus was willing to put on himself all of our imperfection so that we could become the inheritors of his perfection. And why did Jesus do that? There's only one answer. And that one answer has one word: love. And the love of Christ, it bears all things, it believes all things, it hopes all things, it endures all things. Think about that for a moment. Drink from that for a moment. Drink deeply with me. Don't just take a little sip or a nip. It's time to gulp. It's time to let his love cover all things in your life, all secrets, all hurts, all hours of evil, all minutes of worry you've ever had. The mornings you woke up in the bed of a stranger, his love will cover that. The years you peddled prejudice and pride, his love will cover that. Every drug taken, every penny stolen, every crossword, cuss word, or harsh word, every broken promise and lie, his love will cover that. Let it discover along with the psalmist in 103:4, he loads me up with mercy and love. Picture a giant dump truck full of love, and you're right behind it. And God begins to lift the bed until the love starts to slide, slowly at first, then down, 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 until you're hidden and buried, covered in his love. Hey, where are you? Somebody asks. I'm here, covered in love. That's when you take Christmas personally. Let His love cover all things in your life. Do it for His sake, to the glory of His name. Do it for your sake, for the peace of your own heart. And do it for their sake, for the people in your life. Let His love fall on you so yours can fall on them. Shelley and I watched the Dolly Parton Christmas movie this week. Coat of multicolors. And there's a scene in there where the husband and wife are standing outside the door of the church, a door that her husband has never entered. And she pleads with him to come in with her, and he says, "I can't." And he asks her a question, "Why is it so important to you that I go in?" And she took his cheeks in her hand and she said, "Don't you understand? I want you with me for all time, not just here." That the love of Christ has fallen on you and you've taken Him personally. Don't you want your friends and your family to be with you for all time? If His love covers you, it'll flow from you to them. It's time to take Christmas personal. Let's pray. If you've never invited Christ in your life, what better day than Christmas Sunday 2015? Why put off another day praying this most important prayer? Use your own words, but it should say something like this: "Lord Jesus, I don't know all there is to know about you, but I know the world has never been the same. For 2,000 plus years, the world has celebrated the birth of a baby in Bethlehem, but there was more than just His birth that was significant that day. And oh, Jesus, I want to take Christmas personal this year. I don't want to celebrate Santa Claus. I don't want to celebrate mistletoe. I don't want to celebrate just presents under a tree. I want to celebrate. I want to find the truth of Christmas, and I'm ready to make it personal. Lord Jesus, come live in my heart." Dear Father, I know you hear the private, silent prayers of those here in the pews today. Father, thank you that this morning, just as a babe was born quietly in Bethlehem 2,000 years ago, your Son can be birthed in a heart quietly here today. Thank you, Father, for listening to our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.